And welcome to Open Church, Open Bible, here at Christ Baptist Church in Burlington, New Jersey. Our pastor, Pastor Clabon Bogan, Jr. And my name is Minister Marossa Davis, and I will be your instructor for this morning. Our lesson today is entitled, Hezekiah Rallies Judah's Army. And it will be coming from 2 Chronicles, chapter 32, verses 1 through 8, and then we'll drop down and pick up verses 22 and 23. As always, we're using our Union Gospel Press study materials and Bible expositors and illustrators, from which most of the lesson is coming directly from these pages. Before we begin, please join me in a brief word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for who you are. We thank you, Lord, for each one that has joined with us in class today. We pray a blessing upon them and upon their families. We trust that your Holy Spirit will open up our understanding and speak expressingly to each heart about what you would have us to learn from studying today's passage. Be glorified, we pray thee, for each one that does not know you in the pardoning of their sins. We pray that you would speak afresh to their heart about your desire that they too might be saved. Be glorified, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Our text, as we said, you'll be finding it whatever translation you prefer. I will be reading from the King James Version, but whichever version you're reading from in your Bibles or your devices, 2 Chronicles chapter 32, beginning at verse 1. We'll read verses 1 through 8 and then drop down to verses 22 and 23. Verse 1. After these things and the establishment thereof, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came and entered into Judah and encamped against the fenced cities and thought to win them for himself. And when Hezekiah saw that Sennacherib was come, and that he was purposed to fight against Jerusalem, he took counsel with his princes and his mighty men to stop the waters of the fountains which were without the city, and they did help him. So there was gathered much people together who stopped all the fountains and the brook that ran through the midst of the land, saying, "Why should the kings of Assyria come and find much water?" Also, he strengthened himself and built up all the wall that was broken and raised it up to the towers and another wall without and repaired Millo in the city of David and made darts and shields in abundance. And he set captains of war over the people and gathered them together to him in the street of the gate of the city and spake comfortably to them, saying, "Be strong and courageous, be not afraid nor dismayed for the king of Assyria, nor for all the multitude that is with him, for there be more with us than with him. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles." And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah. Verses 22 and 23. Thus the Lord saved Hezekiah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem from the hand of Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, and from the hand of all other, and guided them on every side. And many brought gifts unto the Lord to Jerusalem, and presents to Hezekiah, king of Judah, so that he was magnified in the sight of all nations from thenceforth. Amen. Amen. Hezekiah was the 13th king of Judah. He was a godly man and one of the most devout kings in Jewish history. We can compare this with 2 Chronicles 29, verse 2. He reversed the idolatrous practices of his father Ahaz, King Ahaz, who was one of the most wicked kings Judah had ever known. He cleaned the temple and restored proper worship there. He reinstituted the Passover celebration in Jerusalem and organized the priesthood. However, none of these righteous deeds prevented an attack from the ruthless Assyrian Empire. On the human level, Hezekiah's response was the determining factor as to whether or not Judah would survive. The account of King Hezekiah leading Judah against the powerful Assyrian threat is an example of the preparation and the power of God to protect his people. This week's related scriptures points out the parallel accounts where you'll find the same wording in some cases of this battle found in 2 Kings chapter 18 verses 13 all the way down through chapter 19 verse 37 and Isaiah chapters 36 and 37. So our facts today, our aim, to affirm that Christians will face tremendous pressure and adversity in this life. This life will be no bed of roses. We're all going to face some kind of attack. Principle, to establish that God will never abandon us to face hardships on our own. An application, to learn that the key to overcoming adversity and fear is to call on the Lord in faith. So our lesson outline is in three parts. One, preparation for a siege, verses 1-5. Two, encouragement to stand strong, verses 6-8. And finally, the third section, victory from the Lord, verses 22-23. First part, preparation for a siege. Hezekiah is characterized in both Kings and Chronicles as one of the godliest and most faithful rulers since David. Only Josiah, who reigned later, is credited with a more unblemished record. Hezekiah did have some failings, but they do not appear in this week's lessons, nor do they impinge on any of our concerns. The nation of Judah had fallen on hard times under the evil rule of Hezekiah's father, Ahaz. Hezekiah spent the first 14 years after Ahaz's death conducting a massive reform of Judah's spiritual life. As mentioned earlier, he repaired the temple. He destroyed pagan altars and high places that they had built up. He restored the Passover, which had been neglected, and he refurbished the temple and its workings. These efforts are all described in detail in 2 Chronicles chapters 29-31. We might think that after faithfully carrying out such an extensive program intended to restore honor to the Lord, Hezekiah might have been granted a well-earned time of peace and rest, but it was not to be. The great reforms were hardly completed when Sennacherib, king of Assyria, invaded Judah. He laid siege to all the smaller fortified cities, intending to break their defenses and take them for himself. An Assyrian invasion should not have been a great surprise to Hezekiah. During his fourth year as king, he had watched from the sidelines as Sennacherib's grandfather, Shalmaneser V, laid waste to the northern kingdom of Israel and eventually carted off its population into permanent exile. We'll find this in 2 Kings 17, 3-6, and chapter 18, verses 9-12. Assyria was the most feared power of their time, some say of any time. Their extreme cruelty and overwhelming power was impossible to ignore. Now, in Hezekiah's 14th year, they are back. For Hezekiah, it was bad enough to see the other fortified cities of Judah fall into the Assyrian king's grip. He soon realized that even Jerusalem was not safe, that Sennacherib intended to extend his conquest to the capital as well. 2 Kings 18 adds the detail that Hezekiah, and the name Hezekiah means Yahweh is my strength in Hebrew, initially tried to buy off Sennacherib with a massive tribute. He tried to pay him off, even to the point of stripping off the gold from the doors of the temple, verse 14 to 16. The reprieve was temporary at best. The Assyrian king soon sent a massive army to the gates of Jerusalem to lay siege to the city, in verse 17. His messenger's accusation that Hezekiah was now rebelling against Sennacherib suggests that at some point Hezekiah must have stopped paying the tribute. Second Chronicle account omits the issue of paying tribute, concentrating rather on Hezekiah's defensive preparations. In verse 3 of our text, we are told that he met with his officials and military advisors and made plans to cut off the waters of the fountains outside the city. This is a reference to springs, water springs, located just outside the city, whose flow could be blocked or redirected as needed. The officials meeting with Hezekiah immediately agreed to lend their assistance. They were in unity, in agreement. In short order, a large force assembled and succeeded in stopping the flow of the springs as well as a stream that ran through the fields. They knew the importance of what they were doing. Why should the Assyrian king come to attack us and find an abundant water supply for his troops? This way they would be thirsty and dry. Hezekiah did not stop with securing the water supply. He immediately set about strengthening Jerusalem's physical defenses, beginning with the city wall. Over the years, sections of it had weakened or broken down. Hezekiah repaired these and made them even stronger by building towers on top of them. Then he built an entire second wall around the first one. Hezekiah's wall has been known as the Broad Wall, and a portion of it has been excavated and can be viewed in Jerusalem today. I mention that because some of you perhaps have seen it in your travels to Jerusalem. Archaeologists tell us that Hezekiah built this wall to enclose the west side of the city, which up to then was unprotected by such a defense. It must have taken a large force of workers to construct even that portion so quickly. Of course, it would have taken Sennacherib's considerable time to subdue all of the towns of Judah, so they may have had extra time to get that done. Hezekiah also reinforced a structure known as the Millo. This was a fortification that dated to Jebusite times and to which King David had added, 2 Samuel chapter 5, verses 9. Most archaeologists identify it with a steeped or terraced structure on Jerusalem's south side, southeast side. You may remember when we did a lesson with the mighty men and we talked about the steep structure that they had to climb, and it was almost an impossible task. And David asked, who will climb that steep structure for us? And three of them said they would do it at all risk to themselves, and they did it. They took off and they got all the way to the top of it. This is that structure. In addition to these measures, the king greatly increased the supply of weapons and shields. The makers of these items must have been working feverishly around the clock to get all of this done. Our second section, encouragement to stand strong, verses 6 through 8. Hezekiah's next steps was to appoint military officers, captains of war, over the people. It was important to establish clear lines of authority and organization and not let the people face the enemy as an angry, unruly mob. After choosing his officers, the king asked them to assemble before him in the square at the city gate. It is possible that the "them" refers to all the people, but more likely it was the newly appointed captains. When our lesson text says that Hezekiah spoke comfortably to his men in verse 6, the true meaning is that he spoke words of encouragement. Encouragement, in the true sense of the term, that he instill courage into them. That's one of the things God does. He puts courage into us. So when we hear the word encourage, remember that it's God putting courage into us. That is one of the most important things that a good leader can do. Courage based on true hope, not just a false sense of security or safety or whatever, but courage based on true hope is more critical and more crucial than all the weapons and defensive arrangements combined. As the Lord once exhorted Joshua, you remember Joshua 1:9, Hezekiah urged his men to be strong and courageous. There was no need to fear the Assyrian king or the large army he had left behind. Why? The king offered one reason only, but it was decisive. As large as Sennacherib's army looked, and it was large, a far greater power was present with the men of Judah. In case his officers failed to grasp his point, what he really meant, Hezekiah spelled it out. The Assyrian king had only an arm of flesh at his disposal. He had a great army, but they were only men. It really did not matter how many of them there were. For Hezekiah and his men had the Lord their God with them. He would not only help them, but he would fight their battles for them. It was a bold statement, but it proved absolutely true. Hezekiah's confidence in the Lord proved true. And it was exactly what was needed. The men took courage. That meant they rested themselves. They had confidence in his words. Section 3, victory from the Lord. This is verses 22 and 23. The last two verses of our text summarize the victory that the Lord gave his people. But it is helpful to briefly review the particulars of what happened in between. Sennacherib, who was still besieging in the city of Lachish, must have gotten wind of Hezekiah's morale-boosting speech, his pep talk, for he sent a mocking reply intended to vaporize the newly instilled fortitude, verse 9. In doing so, he struck at the heart of Hezekiah's message. Sennacherib took direct aim at Hezekiah's assurance that the Lord would fight for Judah. He derided the notion, basing his own confidence on the fact that no other nation's gods had stopped him. Why should the people of Judah think that their God would do any better? Verses 11 to 14. Of course, this was an empty boast on Sennacherib's part, because Israel's God was the one true God. He labeled Hezekiah's words of encouragement as a desperate attempt at deception that no one should even listen to. Sennacherib repeated his brazen claim. No God had ever rescued anyone from him or his ancestors, and that was not about to change, verse 15. There followed a concerted campaign by his officials and messengers to heap scorn on the very name of the Lord and his power, verses 16 through 19. It was an unremitting propaganda campaign, calculated to strike fear and doubt in the populace of Jerusalem. Sennacherib's messenger even made sure that they got the message in their own language, and they delivered them into speaking into Hebrew. They spoke in Hebrew to make sure that they understood what they were trying to say. What the Assyrian king never realized was that his mocking attack on the Lord's presence and power sealed his own undoing. God will not be mocked. He's merciful and he's gracious and he's long-suffering, but God will not be mocked. Granted, his words that did have the effect of rattling and bringing great distress to his enemies. However, that only caused Hezekiah to turn more desperately to the one who could help them. Don't let a saint get afraid, because we're going to run to the rock that is higher than we are. Along with the prophet Isaiah, he got a prayer partner, the prophet Isaiah. Hezekiah prayed and cried unto heaven. You got to pray and cry sometimes, saint, but we all know that. The account in 2 Kings provides more details on this. When Hezekiah heard the discouraging reports, he tore his clothes and sent a desperate message to Isaiah, who encouraged him by messenger to remain steadfast. And saints, we have to encourage ourselves to remain steadfast, be encouraged by the word of God to remain steadfast. And God will use us sometimes to encourage someone else to remain steadfast and be encouraged. Isaiah added his own prayers to those of Hezekiah's. That's what we saints do. We pray together one for another. The Lord answered those prayers dramatically, having heard Sennacherib's insults only too clearly. We are told in 2 Chronicles 32, verse 21, that he sent an angel who destroyed the Assyrian army with all its officers. It was twice the size of Hezekiah's. Sennacherib returned home in disgrace, and it gets worse, only to be slain by his sons as he entered his own God, little g, his own God's temple. In 2 Kings chapters 19, verses 35 to 37, we learn additionally that the Lord's angel slew 185,000 Assyrian soldiers, and that Sennacherib was killed by his sons, Adramelech and Sharazar. Such specificity removes any doubt as to the historical truth of the biblical account. Thus, the Lord saved Hezekiah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem from the hands of Sennacherib, the king of Assyria. The Assyrian king found out too late that there was one crucial difference between all the pagan gods that had failed to resist him and the God of Judah. Those pagan gods were all man-made with no more power than a block of wood or stone. When he dared to taunt Judah's God, however, Sennacherib was pitting himself against the Lord of heaven and earth, who possesses all power. The Lord, therefore, had rescued Hezekiah and the people of Jerusalem from Sennacherib's threat, just as their king had assured them he would. As it turned out, he fought their battle for them entirely on his own, requiring no assistance from them whatsoever. The defensive preparations and amassing of weapons were really not necessary, although it was not at all wrong to undertake such readiness. It demonstrated at least that they were not giving up. God won't fight all of your battles for you with you not participating at all. So he just tells us to be prepared, and then we watch, and he will give us instructions as to what we're to do next. The Lord fights for us. The Lord simultaneously rescued them from the hand of all other, that is, from any other threat that might have arisen. That he guided them means that he took care of them and gave them rest. So Jerusalem and all Judah had peace on every side. Praise the Lord. The sudden destruction of 185,000 enemy soldiers does not go unnoticed by surrounding nations. An obvious result of Jerusalem's dramatic deliverance was a boost in the city's prestige. People took notice, especially for the Lord and Hezekiah. Many of the neighboring people brought gift both to the Lord and to the king. Hezekiah's reputation in the region remained on an elevated status from that time forward. Hezekiah's experience provides a vivid illustration of the principle taught by our Lord. Whosoever exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Luke 14:11. When the king and his city were faced with their greatest threat, he did not rally the people around himself. He rallied them to trust in the only one who could save them. And the Lord proved himself fully able and faithful to do just that. Hopefully, not many of us will ever face an army bent on destroying everything that we hold dear. We have faced some things, particularly in this last year with the pandemic, but hopefully we will never face that kind of a situation. But if we do, if Hezekiah could stand up to such a threat with courage and faith in the Lord's protection, can we not also trust him to fight for us in the things that we face? I know we can. In conclusion, there is much for the contemporary Christian to study in today's lesson. God is just as able to care for his children today as he was in ancient times. He is not changed. As Reverend Vernon Wallace used to say, nothing about God has changed. The key to Hezekiah's resolve was his faith in the Lord. Although Judah was tiny in comparison to the massive Assyrian Empire, Hezekiah believed he had the advantage because the Lord was with him and Judah, one with God as a majority. Because Hezekiah turned to the Lord, God heard him and spared Jerusalem from all ruin. Sennacherib had every advantage from a military standpoint, but he lacked the one thing that was most important, the blessing of God. Hezekiah's example demonstrates that the prayer of faith is a weapon mightier than the greatest armies on earth. Hezekiah did not waver in his trust in the Lord. He had led Judah to follow God after a long period of gross idolatry during his father's reign. Hezekiah did not follow his father's footsteps, but he sought the Lord instead. This certainly aided him when the enemy attacked, as God was there to help this righteous king. God may not always protect his people from all earthly harm today, but he will most assuredly keep us from all spiritual harm, to keep us safe spiritually. Our souls are sealed. The evil one cannot touch our soul. And he certainly has protected believers from innumerable earthly harms and can be fully trusted to ensure our ability to do his will. He has also undoubtedly protected us from many threats that we knew nothing about. Isn't that something to think about? There are some dangers that came, people that came to attack you or to harm you, and God has protected us, and we don't even know he did that. So we give him thanks, even for the blessings unseen. So let us keep our eyes of faith on him. God is still looking for people like Hezekiah, whose heart is completely devoted to him. He will greatly honor and work through those who trust him fully. Let us be among those who trust the Lord fully. Praise the Lord for another lesson. The Lord teaches us and we gain so much from his word. Let's see what we can get from each verse that we've studied today. So the first verse is, no one who seeks to live a godly life will go unchallenged. So you can expect some level of persecution. You can expect some level of pushback. You can expect that not everybody is going to be in your corner, but you keep your eyes of faith on the Lord. Verses 2 and 3. We should plan for success with sound strategy and partnerships that do not compromise God's word. Verse 4. God gives wisdom and resources to face both long-term and immediate challenges. Verses 7 and 8. Faith does not discourage preparation, but rather inspires it. That's probably verses 5 and 6. Verses 7 and 8. As believers, we can face enemies and challenges with confidence, knowing God is with us. And verses 22 and 23. God is glorified when we act wisely and trust him. Amen. Amen. During the week or during today, perhaps you can consider these questions. They were all good, so I just saved six of them. Why do you think God allows believers to have enemies? Is there any point in that? Is there any virtue in that? Two, why is it important to understand that faithfulness does not insulate anyone from attacks? You can say, well, I was doing good things. Why would God allow this to happen? Three, where do we find the proper balance between trusting God and making wise plans for our future? Four, what are some areas in our life in which we might experience spiritual attacks today? Five, have you seen God fight your battles for you or for one of his other children? And six, what effects did the miraculous deliverance of King Hezekiah and the people of Judah have on them and on others? And I would add, did reading about it today have any effect on you? Reading about how God delivered Hezekiah, has that in some way encouraged your own heart as you face your difficulties? As always, we are excited to know that you are continuing to study with us and you've joined with us once again today. We're excited that we have been able to be encouraged by the Word of God, especially this past year and a half. We're going into our second year. We thank you for sharing with us, and for those of you that would like to contribute in some way financially to the ministry of Christ Baptist Church or to the Sunday School, we invite you to go to our website, cbcburlingtonnj.org, and there's a give tab on the front page. You would simply click that tab and follow the prompts. If you would like a PDF of today's lesson, you would go to the same website. There's a Sunday School tab. You would click it and you'd be able to download your own PDF of today's lesson. We invite you to join us tonight for Fuel for Courage. It meets at 7 o'clock. There is an interactive Zoom class. And then we also have a recorded version of last week's class on YouTube. We've just come through a week of Vacation Bible School. We had a wonderful week, all week long. It was an exciting time following Jesus, taking up our cross and following him, which was our scriptural theme as we journeyed with Jesus. So we had many of us working together, and we're just so grateful for each one that took the time to be with us during the week and to make the Bible come alive, especially for our young people. Before we close, one of the strengths we're going to do as Hezekiah and Isaiah did. We're going to join together and we're going to cry out to the Lord. There are some concerns that we have that we need to bring before the Lord, and we're going to watch him fight our battles for us. So join me, please, in a brief word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for who you are. We thank you that you're the God of all ages. We thank you, Lord, nothing about you has changed. You're just as powerful now as you were then. You still are putting courage inside of us. You still are advocating for your people. You still are promising that you would never leave us nor forsake us. And you're showing us that in real life. So we just thank you, Lord, for this day, for each one on the call. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless each household that's represented. Whatever the challenges are, whatever the enemy is, whatever the overpowering seeming to be oppressor that is coming up against their lives, we pray, Lord, that you would fight their battles for them. Give them the wisdom of what you would have them to do. We ask forgiveness for every sin, for everything that grieves your Holy Spirit. We're grateful, Lord, that you have blessed Christ Baptist Church to have a new pastor elect, Reverend Jonathan Wilson, and we're excited. We're grateful for how you provided for Pastor Clabon Bogan Jr., how he's yet preaching and teaching and leading and encouraging us, placing courage on the inside of us. And we're grateful for how you're teaching us how to work together. We pray, Lord, for all of the tragedies in our world, the assassination in Haiti. We're praying for the weather situations. We're praying still for those that are dealing with the pandemic, the COVID pandemic. We're praying for those that are dealing with upcoming surgeries or anything, Lord. We're praying for our young people. We're praying traveling mercies. We're just lifting up our nation. You said, blessed that nation whose God is the Lord. And we certainly want to be a nation that honors the one true and living God. Thank you again. We're praying for our churches, that they would stand strong against the attack of the enemy. Bless our pastors as they go into the pulpits and as they bring forth the word of God. May they bring it with power and might. Thank you for each one. Be glorified, we pray, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 God bless you. See you next time.
I worship you.